Hello there, good afternoon. This is Russ Williams. Welcome to another afternoon of football and entertainment here on Absolute Radio. Rock and roll football comes to you from one of the landmark stadiums in English football, and the fans at Anfield are starting to believe that the current crop of players can write some new pages in this famous club's history book. Live and exclusive national radio commentary coming up for you today of Liverpool against West Bromwich Albion right here on Absolute Radio. And it's been almost the perfect start to this Barclays Premier League campaign, says Brendan Rodgers. They've been in contention at the top of the table all season, and in Daniel Sturridge and Luis Suarez, they've got the hottest strike partnership in the country. So plenty to smile about for the Liverpool boss, who insists it's the top four, not the title, that the Reds have in their sights.
Once we're picking up results and we're finding ways to improve that performance level, then of course I'm happy. The squad will evolve. You know, you don't need to be a rocket scientist. You know, you watch in the Champions League level and you see that level and where it's at. So we know we've got a bit of work to do.
None of the Anfield faithful will be silly enough to underestimate West Brom, though. The Baggies did the double over Liverpool last season and already have a famous victory at Old Trafford to boast about this year. Manager Steve Clarke was once the number two on Merseyside, and he says his side have benefited hugely from a good transfer deadline day in August.
We felt in the first three games that maybe we were just lacking in one or two positions, lacking in a little bit of strength and depth, if you like. And when you bring in good players, as we did do, it gives a lift to the players who are already here. So everybody got an extra lift, and I think the performances and the results reflect that.
This is Rock and Roll Football Live, where every Saturday football and music collide, and we witnessed Chelsea's demolition of Cardiff on the show last Saturday as Jose Mourinho's side begin to click into gear. We spoke to the icon that is Roger Taylor of Queen. He believes the good times are back at the bridge.
I have all the confidence in the special one. I think he is such an entertaining person to have on the scene. I just love it. You know, I do get the feeling he's blue through and through because he put us back on the map.
Alongside me in the studio, another man who's blue through and through, Tony DiRigo, will be keeping you up to date with featured games in the Barclays Premier League, including the early kickoff from Selhurst Park. Managerless Crystal Palace take on the leaders in the Premier League, Arsenal. The half-time report from Tony is coming right up for you. And at Anfield for Absolute Radio this afternoon, the former Scotland manager Craig Levein, alongside our match commentator Jim Proudfoot.
Well, these two sides met at the beginning of last season. The first match in charge of both Messrs. Rodgers and Clark, with West Brom winning comfortably. Liverpool have come a long way since then with the signing of Daniel Sturridge's arrival, key to their transformation, but this could be a barometer of their title ambitions. In all but one of their Premier League campaigns, the Baggies have lost away to the side that ended up being crowned champions. The good late transfer business has seen them go unbeaten in six, during which time they've held Arsenal twice and won at Old Trafford.
You're listening to Rock and Roll Football on Absolute Radio.
Southampton against Fulham today in the Premier League as well. Aston Villa at home to Everton. Liverpool against West Brom. Our game, as you heard, Jim there at Anfield with Craig Levein this afternoon. Manchester United take on Stoke City. Norwich City at home to the newly promoted Cardiff City. And tomorrow, some great fixtures coming up. But we're concentrating on the here and now. The early kickoff, Crystal Palace against Arsenal. It's half time. I've really enjoyed it, Tony.
It has been an excellent game. It's a 0-0 at the moment, but I tell you what, the conditions are actually difficult for Arsenal because there's a swirling wind around, and Crystal Palace and Keith Millen has changed the formation of the side. They've gone 4-5-1 and packed the midfield. And Arsenal have found it very difficult to break it down, but physically, Palace are really coming at Arsenal, and they're finding it difficult to play their nice, pretty football in that last third.
They had a bit of a blow, didn't they? Matthew Flamini looked as though a groin strain or something, but he had to come off, didn't he? And Gnabry has come on.
That's right. Yeah, it looked like some sort of adductor strain, but that really hasn't affected them too much. But what they need to get back to is actually winning the fight. They need to go and get the challenges in and win the ball, because at the moment, Palace look certainly the team on the up.
Who's come the closest to a goal?
There's been plenty of opportunities. Actually, Spironi's pulled off a fantastic save from Ramsey, but it's Palace. They've had three or four great efforts. I think Shamak, Bannon, Guardiola as well. So at the moment, it's pretty even, but you just sense if Palace don't get a goal when they're on top, they're going to struggle. Arsenal will put their play passes together better, I think, in the last third and the second
half. Just from, you know, my point of view, they look a different team to what's been the team under Ian Holloway. He's fallen on his sword. He's decided to go. There are five names in the mix. It's my understanding. It's either Alan Kerbishley, Doogie Friedman, who's having a tough time at Bolton, as we all know, Robbie Di Matteo, Neil Warnock, or Tony Pulis. Who's the favourite for you?
I would say Tony Pulis, certainly because, you know, what this side needs is some fight, is some organisation. And you look at the players they bought, 14 players they bought. Pulis has plenty of recent experience in the top league as well, and he'll get them fighting. That's what they need to do. So far, for this 45, they've done exactly that.
How close are they, Crystal Palace Football Club, finally, Tony, to getting to the point of almost no return when there are too many wins adrift to stay up?
Getting close. Next two or three games, simple as that. And I think it's a confidence thing. Today's really important. If they can get something out of the game, a point would be a huge boost. But even their fans, I must admit, today are supporting their side incredibly well.
They are.
And that first 45, they've been superb.
OK, thank you for the moment. Tony DiRigo in the studio with me this afternoon. This is Russ Williams, Rock and Roll Football Live. Jim Proudfoot is up at Anfield. We're going to hear from Jim and talk about our live commentary game today after Huey Lewis in the news. Welcome Roll Football Live. Russ Williams here. Huey Lewis and the news from the 80s. And don't forget, if you love your 80s music, we've got a sister station, Absolute 80s. You can listen to it on digital radio, online. And as you would expect from us, there is a free app that you can download for your iPhone, your iPad, your tablet and your Android device as well. Get stuck in the 80s, but not until we've finished. Ian Wright will be here at 5 o'clock tonight. He's got some great guests coming up. I'll tell you about that in just a minute. Up at Anfield, good afternoon, the perfectly formed Jim Proudfoot.
Afternoon, Russell. Afternoon, Anthony. How are you?
Good afternoon. Very good, thank you, Jim.
Very good, my friend. And there you are at one of the great stadiums of English football. It's always an occasion, Jim, for us to go out on the road to Anfield.
Yeah.
And this season it's a little different, isn't it? Because they've made a good start. They're confident. Their manager appears to have his feet well and truly under the table. And they've made some good signings and perhaps one or two not so good signings.
Yeah, I think that's fair. I think that Brendan Rodgers is certainly in credit in terms of the players that have come in during his reign. But in that last transfer window, having said that, there are certainly a couple, maybe Aspas and Luis Alberto are two that are yet to set the pulses racing. Luis Alberto certainly is one for the future, but he's only started the one game so far, and Aspas is yet to score his first goal. But that said, when you've signed Daniel Sturridge and he scored 13 goals in his last 13 Premier League games, that buys you an awful lot of credit. You can bring in two or three duffers if you're making a judgment as good as bringing Sturridge into the club.
Sturridge and Suarez, you wouldn't want to mark either of those, Tony, would you, in your heyday?
Certainly not. I'd give that to the centre-halves. You take them on and I'll try and pick up the pieces,
quite frankly. I'll just stick to the left wing.
And that's why they're always in with every single game that they play. They're going to be in with a chance with those two strikers up top. And you're right, look, signing Sturridge looks a masterstroke at the moment.
Coutinho, Jim, has been a bit of a loss because he was playing so well, but he should be back next week, shouldn't he?
Well, he should be back next week. I mean, he's had this shoulder problem, but they do think that he's going to be back for the game away to Arsenal next weekend. I think that if Coutinho had played last week in Newcastle, then Liverpool would have won that game. And that means that they would be joint top of the table coming into this round of fixtures. So they're really not too far away. Of course, the bottom line is whether they can maintain it. Last year, they finished seventh. And that was the fourth season in a row that they finished outside the top five. That's Liverpool's worst such run since the 1950s, so a couple of generations. So there's palpable room for improvement. It's just a question whether this good start that they've made to the season can be maintained. You can look back at Albion last year, and at this stage of the season, they're in the similar kind of form and similar kind of position as Liverpool are now. So, you know, you can't take anything for granted.
Last season, Tony, West Brom did the double over Liverpool. In fact, the last three games they've managed to beat them. There is a good feeling about West Brom. Is it coming from nowhere, really? Because if you look at their form, Jim and I, weren't we, Jim? We were chatting this morning when you were on the train, and you said it's a bit of an illusion, West Brom's form, when you actually analyse it.
Well, it's remarkable. And if you think Steve Clarke earlier in the season as well, when they made that extremely bad start, he said, I don't even look at the tables. Well, it's just as well he didn't, because they were in a dire position all of a sudden now. They're comfortable, playing well, getting a result at Manchester United. They're looking very, very good. But I just feel today, Liverpool have a different feeling about them completely. I just think they look a lot more confident. They're looking more of a real deal. And it's going to be very difficult for me for West Brom today.
What do you make of West Brom, Jim? Are they overrated?
Well, I would look back at the way that they fell away last season and look at the start they made this year, where they've only lost twice, but they've only won twice.
Ah.
And I think that the fact that they won at Manchester United, everyone thinks West Brom are the real deal. I would look at it and say they've won three of the last 17 league games. They've taken, since last November, 33 points from 33 matches. Now, I know that Steve has been able to transform the forward line of the club in the last transfer window and late in the transfer window as well. And so the two home defeats that they suffered at the beginning of the season, they've improved the squad since then by bringing in Sessegnon and Anichebe. So it's perhaps a little bit unfair to go that far back and say three wins in 17. But that is the bottom line, it's three wins in 17. They have to come here and be able to consolidate. A positive result here today, a draw would be a very good result for Albion. But it's the matches coming up, Palace at home, Villa at home, Newcastle away. If they are the real deal and they are going to have another top half finish, those are the games that I think they're going to have to perform very well in.
Tony, realistically, before we move on and have another piece of music from Kings of Leon in just a minute, because I rather like them, obviously. Sir Alex Ferguson talking about Liverpool. We're going to come on to Fergie in a little while. But just on the subject of Liverpool Football Club, what is a realistic expectation? Not the title, but top four,
Well, realistic for sure. I mean, when you've got to strikers really playing at the top of their form in Suarez and Sturridge, you've got to be looking at least that. They've got experience, they bought some very good players. I think also, it sounds crazy, but they're an important goalkeeper as well. I think Mignolet's done a great job there. All in all, they're looking very good, so they need to be aiming for the top four. They have to improve. Tough to get in that top four, though, isn't it? There's a few other.
How many players, in your view, are they short of challenging for the title? Sir Alex Ferguson said 8. In his view.
Which is interesting. That means Manchester United must be 10 or something.
Yeah, well, that's what Brendan said.
Exactly. Yeah. No, I still think probably, two or three areas, but you say that. That would give them an 11 that would then challenge anyone, but it's not the 11. I think it is the 16, the 18 over the course of the season. You know, if they can keep those two. What happens if Suarez gets injured or Sturridge then goes down?
What happens if Suarez goes in January?
Goes in January. Aspas just hasn't done it. You know, he's come on with this good reputation in Spain. He's not been there. A big hole there. So they still need one or two players.
Okie dokie. Thank you for the moment, boys. We are going to be talking Sir Alex Ferguson. We're going to be talking about racism in Russia, which reared its ugly head this week in the Champions League. Brighty is going to be here at 5 o'clock tonight. His guests include Ricky Hatton, the former world champion boxer. And if you're into NFL, it's back in London this weekend. Joe Man Montana, what a legend of the NFL. Join him right here as well. Stoney will be here at 5 o'clock as well. This is Rock and Roll Football on Absolute Radio, and as promised, Kings of Leon for you. Super Soaker, Kings of Leon, goal at Selhurst Park, Tony DiRigo.
It certainly was. 1 minute into the second half, and Gudiera plays an awful challenge in the box on Gnabry, takes him down, penalty to Arsenal. Arteta steps up, slots it away, 1-0 to Arsenal.
Still going well, the Gunners in the Premier League. Jim Proudfoot is up at Anfield, and we'll be chatting to Craig Levine, incidentally, a little bit later on, who's in the commentary box this afternoon. Tony DiRigo with me in the studio. Well, let's talk about the Book of Revelations then, gentlemen. Sir Alex Ferguson, I know, Jim, that you've been taking it to bed with you every night, digesting every word.
Rather than Sir Alex.
Can
you not sleep, Jim?
Semicolon. Every, hopefully, no spelling mistakes. Can I just throw something to you two? A lot of people have criticised Alex Ferguson. A lot of people have said, well, you know, it puts his legacy in jeopardy a little bit, this book. I don't agree with that. I think it's fantastic that we've got somebody in football who's prepared to actually have an opinion and say what they believe.
I think his cobbler's about destroys his legacy. His legacy is his legacy. And, you know, him writing a book in his spare time over the last few years is neither here nor there. I think that it's a very entertaining book. What I've read of it, I know that it's had mixed reviews, to say the least. I haven't read it all by any stretch of the imagination, but I was reading some more on the train on the way up here today. It's been very enjoyable. It hasn't been the most enlightening read. It hasn't been perhaps quite as far-reaching as I was expecting it to be. There are two or three chapters over the last 10 or 15 years of Sir Alex's career and life that I would like to know quite a bit of detail about, which aren't in there. But, you know, it's a good read. It's a good footballing book.
Do you think he's held back in the book a little?
I think certainly. He's had to.
Yeah, I think you're exactly right. I think he has to, hasn't he? Because, you know,
why do a book then? Why do
one? But he's still lots of interesting stuff.
Money.
No, he doesn't, but there's still lots of interesting stuff. I'm sure he'd like to get out there and we'd like to read it and know all about it. But you're never going to know the real juicy bits. And I think he's balanced it just about right. The timing, I think, is the interesting point of how it's come out, when it's come out and that. But I think certainly as a read, people will love it.
Well, he gave David Beckham a going over, Roy Keane a going over. He said that Frank Lampard wasn't a top international footballer. He was a very good club player. He said that Liverpool's Steven Gerrard was not a top player. You're going to see him this afternoon. Is he a top player rather than a top player, in the words of Sir Alex, Jim?
OK, well, I mean, this is all you know, synonyms, isn't it? But top player, a world-class player. Is Steven Gerrard currently a world-class player? I don't think he is. A top player, of course. Sir Alex, you're not ever going to say, find a book that Sir Alex goes, do you know what? Paul Scholes was a great player, but I wish I'd had Gerrard because he was better. It was never going to happen. Whatever he thought, that's never going to happen. He's entitled to his opinion. There won't be many people in this part of the world that agree with it, but, you know, it's... as somebody put it to me the other day, it's apples and oranges. They're two different types of players anyway.
Yeah, I mean, at Liverpool, he's won his fair share of trophies. He's never won a Premier League title. You just wonder whether opinion would be as high of Steven Gerrard, Tony, if he hadn't been miraculous in Istanbul, if he hadn't have been absolutely brilliant in that cup final against West Ham. You know, top players do deliver on top occasions, and for me, he did on both of those.
Well, not only on both of those, I think there was certainly a period, wasn't there, probably 2-3 years, he carried Liverpool on his shoulders on his own, and for me, that's what top players are all about. If you look at it now, obviously he's 33, he plays a slightly different way, he has to physically, but no, I would certainly put him up there in that period of his career, for
sure. Today he joins a select band of players that have made 450 Premier League appearances. Last week he joined an equally select band of midfielders that have scored 100 Premier League goals, and yes, there are a few penalties in there, but one insight that was given to me was a story that Brendan Rodgers, when he came to the club, said to Steven Gerrard, okay, I'm a huge admirer of yours, but I want you to play in a different way. Gerrard didn't at any stage go, no, I'm not changing my game. He sat down, he listened to what Brendan Rodgers had to say, and he's implemented it and taken it all on board and has done exactly what the manager wanted him to do. Now, there'll be plenty of people that would think that they were bigger, you know, bigger than the manager coming in, particularly when you've got the kind of status at a club that Steven Gerrard has here, but not a bit of it.
Let's move on to an ugly subject in football that we're forever coming back to, racism. We saw Yaya Toure, in his own words, he's a fluent Russian speaker, by the way, Yaya Toure, so he understands when people say things to him in the Russian language. He's adamant that he was on the end of some fairly unpleasant racial abuse. It's interesting that out of Moscow in the last 24 hours, they think that this is a smear campaign from the English media because we're bitter that we didn't get the World Cup in 2018. I think that's nonsense. The fact of the matter is, this is still a problem, isn't it, Tony? This kind of behaviour in that part of the world, in Eastern Europe, in Spain. And what can we do about it? I mean, you can't just boycott a World Cup that easily, can you? As Arsene Wenger and Jose Mourinho said yesterday.
No, you certainly can't. But it's disgusting that that is still happening, you know, in this day and age. And I played before, 10, 15 years ago in Italy, and it happened there. The Eastern Bloc countries, you know, it was happening there. And, of course, Russia, we still have it now today. I just hope somehow that the awarding of the World Cup to them, they can actually force their hand in some format, some way or another. We have to show them what the right way is. But I was very disappointed in the referee. You know, there is a system and a protocol in place that they just completely missed. And now everyone will be looking at what the punishment is. This sends out a very clear message. It's okay, you know, parading the T-shirts and saying all these lovely things on TV. We've seen the advertisements. Do some action. Let's have a look now at what they're going to do.
Jim, fines have been dished out, pathetic fines, to other clubs in Europe that we've spoken about on this show. Lazio, for example, one or two Spanish clubs. How do we deal with this problem, not only in Russia, but what is the appropriate fine? Is it closed doors, no crowd allowed in? What do we do, Jim?
A mission from European competition.
Just kick them out straight away.
Absolutely, without a shadow of a doubt. The problem, of course, is that any potential legal challenge, because the last two or three very high-profile incidents, the clubs or the federations have completely denied that it has happened, as we've seen from CSKA in Moscow, as we saw from the Serbian FA after an England under-21 international this time last year. They just deny, they refuse to acknowledge that they have a problem. That is what we have to get to the heart of. And, you know, it's changing that mindset and acknowledging that there is a problem in the first place.
So it's Sepp Blatter and Michel Platini have got to do something about it.
Act
like men. Yeah. Okay, well, hopefully something will happen because it's unacceptable and it shouldn't continue. Righty, I'm sure, we'll be touching on this subject a little bit later on. If you've got something to say, you can tweet us at RNRFootball. You can send us a message on our Facebook page. Text lines are open as well, 81215. To send a text, it'll cost you 50 pence plus your standard network rate. And you can phone right here after 5 o'clock on 0330 123 1215, hopefully to talk about the positives of the beautiful game as well. This is Rock and Roll Football, football and music colliding every Saturday afternoon. It's another massive game for Chelsea tomorrow. They're at home to Manchester City at Stamford Bridge. One man with a keen eye on that fixture is Queen drummer Roger Taylor. His fifth studio album, Fun on Earth, is out on the 11th of November, and he spoke to Absolute Radio's Martin Lee on a whole range of subjects, from Bohemian Rhapsody to the blues.
My writing process isn't as fast as that. I mean, you get these people that churn out a song a day. Yeah. I can't really do that. I sort of have the germ of an idea, then I sort of work on the song. And if I think it's working, I continue. And if I don't, I ditch it.
Do you do anything to look after your voice? Do you have
no,
anything?
No, not really. I gave up smoking about a long time ago, many, many years ago. I don't do anything to really look after it. But I find the more I sing, the better the voice. You know, 2-3 days to warm up, or rehearsal, and then the voice sort of deepens and gets better.
God knows I want to break free.
You are an incredibly busy man, along with your solo stuff and touring and playing live. There's the stage show, We Will Rock You. Are you taking more of a back seat with that, or do you still get a little bit involved sometime?
I was in Baltimore where it opened for an American tour, so, you know, with a fantastic American cast. So in that sense, I'm still involved. You know, it's, you know, you feel you have to go and support it.
You and Brian still go along when you can and support those.
Brian,
that's amazing.
You know, Brian plays a solo in Bohemian Rhapsody, etc. And, you know, which is, it gives it a little special extra things on first nights, and which is good. And I just go along and give my support.
I was told you're a Chelsea fan, is that correct?
I am indeed.
Is the return of Jose going to fix everything for you?
The happy one. Yeah, I have all the confidence in the special one. Yeah, I think he is such an entertaining person to have on the scene. I just love it. You know, it's. I mean, you know, I do get the feeling he's blue through and through.
Do you think so? Do you think for a long time he wanted to come back?
I do, yeah. Yeah, and I think a lot of Chelsea fans were so gutted when he left, you know, because he put us back on the map.
Is this going to be your season again?
I think it could be.
You're listening to Rock and Roll Football on Absolute Radio.
The Mighty Queen on Rock and Roll Football Live. It's the countdown to the big kickoff on Absolute Radio. We're at Anfield. Liverpool against West Brom is our commentary game this afternoon. You won't miss a kick. And Jim Proudfoot has got all the team news from Anfield for you next.
Rock and Roll Football with Sky Sports.
Watch all six Sky Sports channels wherever you are with Sky Go.
Absolute Radio. You're listening to Absolute Radio.
Landlords, if one of your properties has a blocked drain, broken boiler, or electrical fault, call the British Gas Team. We offer ongoing care, one-off repairs, landlord safety certificates, and multi-property discounts. Visit britishgas.co.uk. British Gas, looking after your world. Conditions apply.
Oh, they've got to be here somewhere.
Walkers have lost some of their delicious homegrown ingredients. Can you find them for a guaranteed reward?
Oh, sorry, madam.
There are millions of amazing rewards. You could even land up to £10,000. Every pack's a winner.
Aha! A tomato!
George, that man's in our fridge again.
Buy a special bag and play Gary's Great Ingredient Hunt at walkers.co.uk.
18 or over. Purchase necessary except in Northern Ireland. Full terms and conditions at walkers.co.uk.
Can't be done. That's what they said when we challenged one man to drive a Honda Civic diesel from Surrey to Amsterdam and back on a single tank of fuel. Can't be done, they said. We say, yeah, it can. That's Dutch for yes, it can. The Civic 1.6 diesel, with our most fuel-efficient engine yet, delivering an impressive 118 brake horsepower while emitting only 94 grams of CO2 per kilometre, meaning you pay no car tax.
The semi-flex fare. The if the meeting finishes early, fly home early fare. The not hanging around at the airport trying every perfume in duty-free fare. The home in time for tea fare. The happy husband fare. The maybe he'll give you a massage fare. The probably not fair. The semi-flex fare. British Airways. To fly, to serve, to Europe.
Selective flights to European destinations from London Heathrow, London Gatwick and London City airports. Change of flight may be made on the day of departure with no additional cost. Visit ba.com/Europe for full terms and conditions.
This is Now TV. This is a no-contract 24-hour day pass to all six Sky Sports channels this weekend. This is the Mackems meet the Magpies, while Chelsea take on City, and all the action from the ATP World Tour. How's that? Oops, sorry, wrong sport. This is all for just £9.99. Get your 24-hour Sky Sports day pass at nowtv.com.
Now TV is powered by Sky. Content streamed for device limits, compatibility and full terms. See website.
This weekend at Homebase, there's 15% off everything, in-store and online. That's 15% on top of our other great offers. Homebase. Love your home this autumn. Exclusions apply.
This is a padlock. It keeps valuable things protected. Your savings are protected too. That's what the Financial Services Compensation Scheme is here for. Backed by government, FSCS automatically protects your savings up to £85,000 should anything happen to your bank, building society or credit union. You'll probably never need us, but like a padlock, it's nice to know we're here. Search FSCS Protected for details.
Rock and roll football with Russ Williams, Jim Proudfoot, Ian Stone and Ian Wright on Absolute Radio with Sky Sports.
8 minutes past two, Russ Williams here. Good afternoon at Selhurst Park at the moment. The early kickoff in the Barclays Premier League. Crystal Palace nil, Arsenal 1. Mikel Arteta with a penalty a minute into the second half. And it was a penalty according to Tony DiRigo, who's with me in the studio. And I can tell you that Mikel Arteta has just been sent off by the referee. So Arsenal a goal up but down to 10 men. In the Championship, Barnsley 1, Sheffield Wednesday 1, they're still playing, and Huddersfield 2, Leeds United 2, Tony, and they're still playing there as well. But we're going to be at Anfield this afternoon. Liverpool against West Brom. Steve Clarke, Albion's manager, used to be number 2 at Anfield, didn't he? And West Brom have won their last 3 games against Liverpool, but under Brendan Rodgers, the Reds are a slightly different proposition this season. Sturridge and Suarez will be looking to be the difference today at Anfield for Rock and Roll Football. Your match commentator is Jim Proudfoot.
Well, to fans of my immediate generation, Anfield was the archetypal fortress, and recollections of my childhood are that it made headline news whenever Liverpool lost here. At one stage, from January 1978, they went a shade over 3 years without a defeat at Anfield. Now that, of course, was the club's halcyon age, and comparisons with football more than 30 years ago are futile. But it does put it in perspective when you look at the home form prior to Daniel Sturridge's arrival. At that stage, Liverpool had won only 8 and lost 8 out of 20 matches here. Sturridge's arrival has enabled Liverpool to win matches where they've been dominant, and the home form has improved accordingly. So whilst West Brom travel north, having won their last 2 games here, this is a different prospect. Or is it? Because Liverpool's problem in defending set pieces hasn't gone away, and scoring from them remains one of the Albion's strengths. Last season, Gareth McCauley scored here from a set piece. Last week, Paul Dummett gave the 10 men in Newcastle the lead against Liverpool from a set piece. And Liverpool's only home defeat this season against Southampton was settled by a header from a corner. Now, Craig Levein was pretty useful at set pieces in both penalty areas in his time. Why is it then, Craig, that such an apparent weakness is being exposed time and time again without Liverpool being able to get it sorted out?
Yeah, I mean, it can become an issue, of course. I mean, when you say they've lost four goals in the last five games, is it, from set pieces, then teams are very quick to pick up on that. And you might find that in the lead up to the match today that Steve Clarke and his backroom staff will be fully aware of Liverpool's apparent weakness at set pieces, and I'm sure they'll be working on it. So as weeks go by, then you find that other teams recognise it and work even harder, and it becomes more difficult to stop. So I'm pretty sure Brendan will have looked at whether he's going with a man-to-man marking system or whether he's going with a zonal system. I don't know. I'm looking at the Liverpool team. I don't know if they've got the height to play zonal marking at corners in particular. But I mean, it's something that we need to stop immediately, because, as I say to you, if they allow it to continue and other teams recognise it, as the weeks go by, it becomes more and more difficult for them to defend set pieces.
That Liverpool team today shows just the one change from that drew at Newcastle last week. Victor Moses drops to the bench with Lucas coming back in. He was on family leave last week as his partner gave birth to a daughter. Lucas back in the Liverpool side today. So just the one change from that team at Newcastle. Mignolet in goal. Toure, Skrtel and Sacco are back three. Johnson and Sissoko at wing-backs. Henderson, Lucas and Gerrard in midfield. Suarez and Sturridge up front with Agger, Luis Alberto, Moses, Allen, Sterling, Kelly and Jones on the bench. Well, let's look at West Brom. Their win at Old Trafford had observers purring, Russ amongst them, but it remains one of only two victories all season. And while they have earned plaudits for their style of play, they've now won, as I mentioned earlier, only three of their last 17 Premier League games either side of the summer break. Is it too simplistic, Craig, to say that the transfer business late in the window will remedy that with a complete remodelling of the forward line?
Well, evidence would suggest that things are improving, wouldn't it? When you can go and win against Manchester United, then that's fairly significant. I know United have their weaknesses just now, but it's fairly significant they've managed to win there. And I think it's a difficult question, because time will tell, won't it? I mean, that's a poor record. They only have won three times in 17 matches. But recently they look as if things have certainly turned up the way. And you've got to give people time to settle into the team. Sessegnon was a surprise to me that Sunderland let Sessegnon go. I watched a lot of Sunderland the last couple of seasons, and he was always one that would provide a spark. And of course, with Steve losing Lukaku, I thought he had to do something. And you know, Sessegnon, he's certainly a player that provides a spark. He's unpredictable. His goal scoring record probably isn't what he would like it to be, but he's a recognised sort of effective striker in the Premier League, and I think it'll be a good addition to the squad. But it looks as if things have turned for the better in recent times, but this will be probably the biggest test for a while. I mean, okay, they did beat Manchester United, but this will be a big test.
Well, they make one change as well from the side that drew at Stoke. There's no sign of Berahino, the man who scored the winner at Old Trafford. Anelka, the former Liverpool player, comes in to replace him, which would make you think that Anelka will start on the left-hand side with Anichebe going through the middle up front, unless Steve Clarke changes the habit of a lifetime and changes from a 4-2-3-1 formation. So it's likely to be Myhill in goal, Jones, McCauley, Olsen and Ridgewell, Jakob and Malumbu, Amalfitano, Sessegnon and Anelka, with Anichebe up front. On the bench for West Brom, Berahino, Morrison, Long, Brunt, Vidra, Lugano and Luke Daniels, the substitute goalkeeper. It's an overcast, murky afternoon on Merseyside. Kick-off for us about 45 minutes away.
OK, thank you, Craig. Thank you, Jim. Tony DiRigo in the studio with me. Arsenal down to 10 men at Crystal Palace. It's pretty much all Palace at the moment, as you would expect. Was it a sending off for Arteta?
Well, I think Chris Hoy actually got it right, because the last man, simple as that. It was Arsenal pushing up, all in the Crystal Palace's half. Jedinak makes a great clearance. He's had a fantastic game, by the way. And it was Arteta alone with Shamak. Shamak knocked it past him. They tangled legs. Down he went. Yep, had to be a red for me.
And Palace would love to get something out of this game. It's sometimes extremely difficult to break down 10 men, and Arsenal are no fools. So Arsene Wenger has just made a substitution. Jack Wilshere's come on. He's going to shore things up in midfield and try and keep Palace at bay, I suppose.
Exactly right. But also, I do think Palace will be starting to push on. There are going to be spaces at the back as well. So just watch for an Arsenal break to get a second goal. But Palace, they show so much spirit today. I really have been impressed with them. I just wonder where that spirit's been for the previous games.
Yeah, OK. Tony, watching it. By the way, Huddersfield 2, Leeds 2. There's been a goal. Huddersfield 3, Leeds 2. Sorry to tell you that.
Yeah, thanks for that. Great.
Full time in the Championship. Barnsley 1, Sheffield Wednesday 1. This is Rock and Roll Football Live. Liverpool against West Brom, a live game. You won't miss a kick. Craig Levine and Jim Proudfoot here with full match commentary from 3. Ian Wright and Ian Stone from 5. Crystal Palace and Ian Holloway parted company, didn't they, on Monday after the defeat against Fulham with those spectacular goals. Many believe it might have been Martin Yol whose job was on the line had they failed to beat the Eagles on Monday. Fulham chairman Shahid Khan spoke to us at Rock and Roll Football about life as a Premier League owner.
The idea of relegation, promotion, I mean, that adds a whole different twist to it. Being more dependent on the supporters is another aspect of how you relate to them, what you do. So, issue of sustainability in Premier League long term, I think, is another challenge. But the fans are very passionate. I mean, Craven Cottage, Fulham, it's an iconic stadium. I think things are shaping up right now. I think I've been there since July. Our goal was, hey, they finished 12. Can we do a little bit better? That's what, you know, what we're aspiring to. And so far, right now, we're on track.
Berbatov, right-footed shot! Into the bottom right-hand corner! Fulham lead again! What a game! What a turnaround!
You know, we want to get into a sustainable model, which is we have a Riverside Stand expansion that's going through the works of approval. I think that's very, very important for the club. To have that where we can have, generate the revenue that can be invested in players and facilities in a virtuous circle. Moving forward, I think, our goal is to work at it step by step.
Shahid Khan on Rock and Roll Football Live. He's the owner of Fulham. He's the owner of the Jacksonville Jaguars. They host the San Francisco 49ers at Wembley Stadium tomorrow. Don't forget, live coverage begins from 4:30 with Adam Hunt and friends. Absolute Radio 90 is a UK radio exclusive. And Wrighty is going to be joined by the 49ers legend Joe Montana from 5 this evening here on Absolute Radio. So you get the best of American and English football as they collide in an NFL kind of way with that face paint from 5 o'clock. Good luck to Brighty. Tony, how did Crystal Palace not equalise there?
Well, Sir Chesney, what a save it was. And the ball just bounced on the volley to Jedinak, fully, 22 yards out. He caught it superbly well, flying into the top corner. But the Arsenal keeper, great save. Brilliant save.
What a save. Jim Proudfoot at Anfield. Let's go through with Tony the Premier League football today. And I tell you what, we've just heard from Shahid Khan. Fulham have won their last two. Spectacular game on Monday and a great victory for Martin Yol and his players on Monday at Crystal Palace. But Southampton are fifth and they're going well and they've got the best defensive record in the Premier League, Jim.
Just the 3 goals conceded so far, and it's on that basis that I think that Southampton will be good enough today. And there's plenty of speculation down my way that Ricky Lambert is going to be recalled. That's what they're expecting on the South Coast, and that Lambert will be back in today. And I think that Saints will be good enough. I don't think it will be a classic. I don't think it's going to be easy on the eye. I can guarantee we're not going to see a goal as good as Kasami's was the other night. I'm going to go for 2-0 at Southampton.
What about Steve Sidwell's goal the other night? The best goal he's ever scored in his career, and it's forgotten.
Completely forgotten because
of that goal. Although I have to say, I thought Ibrahimovic's goal was a goal of the week, better than the Arsenal first goal last weekend. And Kasami's for me.
But he's just showing off. He got 4, didn't he?
Unbelievable. For goodness sake. But anyway, Martin Yol, he's won the last two. Is this the beginning of their revival now?
Well, he certainly like to think so, but let's don't forget the two away results that they've won have been, I think, at Sunderland and, of course, at Crystal Palace, bottom two. So, no, I agree with Jim in that Southampton just looking very good. When you build from the back, when you've got a base that does not give goals away, you've always got a chance. But going forward, I see goals at Southampton at home. Yep. It's all Southampton for me.
Aston Villa against Everton. Between them, they've got 16 top-flight titles, but none in the history of the Premier League. Christian Benteke, Jim, starts for Aston Villa today, but they've only got 14 points from a possible 48 at Villa Park.
That's an extraordinary record. The one that I've got written down is 31 points from the last 36 home games over the last couple of years. And you know my default position. We talk about this every other week.
We do.
I always look for a reason why Aston Villa aren't going to lose at home, and I can't find one today. I think that Everton's ability with Lukaku and their ability from set pieces will be enough to expose a fragile Aston Villa back line.
What a matchup that is. Lukaku against Benteke.
Well, there's the reason, I think, for Aston Villa to actually maybe get a result at home. But I'm not sure to be the, all 3 points, because I think Everton certainly looked very good. And you're right, Lukaku, what an excellent striker he is. But I think players at Everton are enjoying their football under Martinez as well. They're looking very, very good. Obviously, Baines is in great form.
Four out of five.
No, exactly.
Five,
and they've got some quality players. So it's going to be tough for Aston Villa. But Benteke coming back and starting, hopefully that gives them a boost.
Manchester United are home to Stoke City this afternoon. Stoke, the team that just can't score. And Manchester United, Robin van Persie should be back for them today. Rio Ferdinand and Vidic back in the centre of defence, because their central defensive lineup last weekend against Southampton just didn't look right. And there's something about, I think, the whole team of Manchester United that doesn't look right. Their manager is David Moyes, as we know. His answers, I think, are a little bit shorter than they used to be when he was Everton manager. And he says, even though they've not had a great start, it's too early to write United out of the title race.
Well, there's only 2 months of the season gone, so we conceded in the 90th minute against Southampton. There'll be a lot of slip-ups by teams between now and the end of the season. But obviously, we don't want to have any more if we can help it.
It's all very well, Jim. David Moyes saying there's going to be a lot of other teams that are going to slip up between now and the end of the season. United have slipped up early.
They have slipped up early, and it's the worst start that they've had in the Premier League era. Clearly, there's massive room for improvement as far as they're concerned. But before a ball was kicked, none of us lot thought that Manchester United were going to win the title. So you have to say, how far really have they fallen from grace? They could have won last week, Russ. You watched that game and Southampton were excellent second half. But if United had dispatched their chances in the first half, it would have been a different story. They've had two more points on the board and their record would have looked much, much better than it actually does. I think today, against the Stoke side, they've only scored once in the last five Premier League games. They'll be plenty good enough.
Well, I'll give you a worse stat than that. It sounds worse, Tony. Four goals this season. That's all they've scored. Stoke City is pitiful, really.
It is, but they only conceded seven, so they've got one bit right, but the other bit is woefully wrong. You're exactly right. Going to Old Trafford, you know, you think they'd have to score at least one, maybe two. Can you see them doing it? No, I certainly can't. And I think Man United as well. Real Sociedad, they could have had three or four that night as well. That would have given them confidence. No, it's a home win for me.
OK, moving on. The bottom two clubs in the Barclays Premier League have both changed managers. The club currently sitting third bottom, Norwich City. But their Canaries coach, Chris Hughton, is not panicking.
We're actually a point more than what we were at this stage last season, and then we're able to go on a very good run, and that's what the game is about. The game is about playing with confidence, hopefully having your good periods where amongst that confidence you can pick up points, and we all know at this stage of the season what a win can do.
Tony, we all love Chris Hughton. He's very much a part of English football, and his contribution has been significant. He's under pressure at Norwich City, but he would say, look, we're a point better off than we were at this time last season, and we finished 11th.
You've got to pay a lot of money for these points, don't you? Because they've spent and invested a lot of money in the summer.
Well, that's a valid argument, isn't it?
Well, it is a valid argument, but I think today's huge. I think it's absolutely huge against another side that's come up and invested money.
Well, and Malky Mackay's under pressure too, isn't
exactly,
it?
Having their own issues. So if they can grab 3 points at home, things look very, very different. Jump up to 10 points, suddenly you're in the mix in that mid-table again. But he's under pressure. Home games are important for Norwich. They've got to get their certainly new signings firing. Today's a big game.
Jim, would you expect Malky Mackay and Chris Hughton, both of them, to be running these clubs at Christmas?
Oh, at Christmas? Well, that's a difficult question. I think that they both might be out of a job, unfortunately, by the end of the season. I don't think that would... or out of their current job at the end of the season. I don't think either of them will be out of work at the end of the season, but they both might have left where they are now. I think that the writing's on the wall for Malky after everything that's happened with Ian Moody, as we spoke about last week. I think that that's just a ticking time bomb, and Malky will go sooner rather than later. I hope that Chris Hughton is able to turn it around and that he's given the stay of execution he deserves.
Tomorrow, Sunderland against Newcastle, a minor affair in the early kickoff. It's come too early, isn't it, really, guys, for Gus Poyet this game, but he's got to face it head on, obviously.
But it's come too early unless he wins it. If he wins it,
it's
like Di Canio. I mean, the win for Sunderland at Newcastle last season bought Di Canio time, made him an instant hero amongst the Sunderland supporters. And if Gus can mastermind a victory against the old enemy tomorrow in his first home game in charge, then straight away he's off and running.
Well, I'm not sure he's going to be off and running. That's the difficulty. I was really disappointed at the performance at Swansea, and looking through the stats
They were battered, weren't they?
They were absolutely battered, but it's the way they got battered and when they conceded goals. And I'm looking through all the sides in the Premier League. In the last 15 minutes, I always sense a good side will hang on. Well, Sunderland conceded 8 goals. They just collapsed time after time, and they did it again last week with Gus Poyet. They're going to struggle.
And Newcastle are much better, Jim, this season, aren't they, after being woeful last year?
Well, funnily enough, Craig and I were talking about this downstairs on the back of Craig's last game with us at St James's Park. And the point he made was that Newcastle are better than the results and the position in the table suggest.
Yeah, it's a good point.
And on the back of that, I've got to admit, I agree with him. I just think that the Poyet euphoria will carry Sunderland some distance tomorrow. I've got it down as a draw.
Right then, it's Mourinho time. Chelsea manager Jose Mourinho is going to sit in the dugout tomorrow. Just a fine for him after his sending off against Cardiff City last Saturday. Mourinho's got no problem with the fine, but he still believes he shouldn't have been sent to the stands.
What I don't think is fair is that it's not a reason to be sent off. It's the same thing I find many times with players, that the yellow card is more than enough, and certain actions are not actions for that card. So it's a bit similar.
He's lucky to be in the dugout, I think, but he's going to be there, and they need him for this one, Tony. This is a marker game. This is who's going to set down a marker.
You're exactly right, and I think the actual record between the two managers, Spain, is very much in Mourinho's favour, but that doesn't mean anything. This is the English Premier League. It's a big game at Stamford Bridge. I'm really looking forward to it. Two quality sides out there, but you're right. The marker can be set down, and I think Chelsea will do it.
David Silva, Jim, back for Manchester City. No Vincent Kompany, though, but Silva's a major plus for them.
He is, but defensively, they've got problems away from home. We were there when they lost 3-2 at Manchester City. They lost 3-2 at Cardiff earlier in the season away from home. And if they defend as they did in those two games tomorrow, they will lose. I do believe it is as simple as that. The thing is, I think that they are improving slowly defensively. They've had a couple of excellent results in Europe. I think that they will get something tomorrow. I think it will be a hugely entertaining game, and I think it's going to be a couple each.
What do you think?
Well, I'm going for Chelsea. I think just certainly that indecisiveness.
Well,
I just think, at the back at Man City, that's just really not good at all. Then they've got a soft centre in that they're making mistakes. Wonderful players going forward. I really like them. When we've seen them, they've taken control of games. They won't do that against Chelsea, but I think we'll see some goals and a ledge to Chelsea.
Swansea at home to West Ham. West Ham very poor in front of goal against Manchester City. I don't think there's any escaping from that. Apparently Andy Carroll could be back in training in a couple of weeks. Can't happen quick enough, I would have thought that, for Big Sam. And Swansea, Jim, it's their third game in 8 days. I wonder if they'll be a little tired.
Well, I think of the sides in the Premier League in European competition this year, playing in Europe is going to stretch Swansea more than it's going to stretch the others in terms of the relative lack of depth of resources. But I still think that they will have enough. You talk about West Ham being poor in front of goal against Manchester City. Russ, you're absolutely right. But they weren't poor against Tottenham. Don't want to rub it in. But you wonder which West Ham is going to turn up.
Exactly.
I still can't get my head around the fact that they won 3-0 at White Hart Lane.
Neither can I.
In the context of their other results away from home before and since. So I don't know. They're a really hard side to predict. A tentative home win for me.
Spurs at home to Hull City, and they play again in the Capital One Cup on Wednesday. Tom Huddleston coming back to White Hart Lane. And
yep.
I always think it's a bit dangerous when you get a player who feels that he should be part of a, inverted commas, a bigger club. And I think, he saw the writing from AVB was on the wall for him there. And that's always dangerous when a player like that comes back. He's a great passer of the ball, and he still hasn't cut his hair because he hasn't scored since 2011. Stranger things have happened, Tony.
Well, no, certainly. Then I think he's got something to prove. He wants to come back and show that they shouldn't actually release him. But I just think it's going to be probably too much for Hull. They're missing one or two players as well. McGregor's a key player, obviously a goalkeeper. I think Aluko up front, the jack in the box, he's not playing either.
They'll miss
him as well. So I just feel that certainly Tottenham, I will have more than enough to actually win that game. Probably 2-0 for me.
Jim? I'm just hoping for some Kendo Nagasaki style unmasking and hair-cutting ceremony on the pitch. As soon as he scored the goal, the celebration should be someone whips the clippers out of their pocket, does it there and then.
Yes.
That's what the fans want to see.
Yeah, but he might not score. Tottenham, you know, the one at Villa, but they were terrible against West Ham, or West Ham were very good and, you know, could finish, Jim, as you said. But they do specialise in clean sheets, and that's what AVB will want at the Lane tomorrow.
Yeah, I mean, their record in terms of clean sheets is fantastic. I think it's 12 in 15 games in all competitions so far this season. Hull are good at scoring from set pieces, and I think that Hull will score, but I think that Spurs will probably edge it.
Goal at Selhurst Park, Tony DiRico. It hasn't been coming, but it has.
Well, you could just sense it on the break. Arsenal have done it. They've gone two up. Ramsey with an excellent run in the left-hand channel. He's chipped it across for Giroud. A flying header in the back of the net. It is Crystal Palace 0, Arsenal 2.
Well, let me fire something back at you. Huddersfield 3, Leeds United 2.
Thank you.
A full-time score. You just sit down, have a nice cup of tea and get ready for your game this afternoon. We'll both be watching games. I'm going to be watching Aston Villa against Everton. Have you been allocated a game yet by the producer?
I certainly have. Manchester United Stoke.
Oh, I think you're going to find that very interesting. Craig Levein is going to be having a chat with me about the game this afternoon and issues within the modern game, without sounding too sinister, particularly the Scotland manager's job. More of that in just a couple of minutes. And we're going to hear from the managers as well. Liverpool against West Brom. It's live. It's here on Rock and Roll Football.
Rock and Roll Football with Sky Sports.
See some of the greatest sporting events across all six Sky Sports channels in stunning HD and wherever you are with Sky Go.
You're listening to Absolute Radio.
This is a crash helmet. You wouldn't ride a motorbike without one. It protects you when you need it. Your savings are protected too. That's what the Financial Services Compensation Scheme is here for. Backed by government, FSCS automatically protects your savings up to £85,000 should anything happen to your bank, building society or credit union. You'll probably never need us, but like a crash helmet, it's nice to know we're here. Search FSCS Protected for details.
Every goes into every Renault. Our multi-championship winning Formula One engine technology also goes into the heart of every new Renault Clio for greater fuel efficiency and lower emissions. Prices start from only £129 per month with 1 year's free insurance included. Sign up fee £149, advanced rental £2624, 48 monthly rentals of £129, final rental £3835. For free insurance, exclusions and conditions apply. For details and to book a test drive, visit Renault.co.uk.
This year...
Hello, Potsy. How's your girlfriend?
She's fantastic.
Planning on meeting her at any point?
Comes a movie about finding love.
I've never done this before.
It's okay. I've had thousands.
And following your dreams.
Paul's going to be a wonderful singer.
I can sing!
I trade both my ears for a pint right about now.
Critics are calling it the best British comedy in years.
Stop moaning and start thrusting your pelvis in my general direction.
James Corden, Mackenzie Crook, Julie Walters and Colm Meaney. One chance. In cinemas now.
This weekend at Homebase, there's 15% off everything, in-store and online. That's 15% on top of our other great offers. Homebase. Love your home this autumn. Exclusions apply.
From little runarounds to roomy people carriers and everything in between. If they need new tyres, you'll find them at ATS Euromaster. You'll also find great offers like buy one, get one half price on Avon and Pirelli tyres. For your nearest centre, call 0800 60 10 60. ATS, put us to the test. Conditions and exclusions apply.
Meet the Nintendo 3DS family. The 3DS, compact and light. The Nintendo 3DS XL, offering a larger screen. And now... introducing the brand new Nintendo 2DS. Plays all your Nintendo DS and 3DS games, apps and software without the 3D effect. Available in two different colours, it's our best value handheld. The Nintendo 2DS, the newest member of the 3DS family.
When I signed up for an adventure challenge to raise funds for the Prince's Trust, I wasn't expecting 30 people at work to sign up with me. There was a real buzz in the office. Some people even gave up smoking and started exercising for the first time in years. The Trust helped us with all the preparation and the final event was fantastically organised. We're still buzzing about it. We made stronger bonds on the challenge than we have in years as work colleagues. It was an experience that years of management and leadership training just can't replicate. And we know the money raised will help disadvantaged young people build a positive future for themselves.
Every year, the Prince's Trust helps thousands of young people into work, education, or training. But we can only continue our work with the support of individuals and companies who care about the future of our young people. go to princes-trust.org.uk/get involved to find out how you can change a life. Thank you.
The Chris and O'Connell Breakfast Show.
We're giving away £1,000 every single day in November.
£1,000 every day in November.
What would you do with £1,000?
A subscription to Rail Magazine, a Greg's Cookie, a single cargo trip to Brazil, and half an Arsenal season ticket.
Me? Monkey Butler in spats and a fedora, the ultimate Steven Seagal collection, Blu-ray, Breaking Bad RV.
Throughout November, you can win £1,000 every day.
The Chris and O'Connell Breakfast Show. Built by Wix.
Absolute Radio.
This is Rock and Roll Football on Absolute Radio. Live from Anfield.
I don't think we can win the league. I suppose we could, but I doubt it. I think when you look at the fixtures, the way they've panned out so far, Arsenal still haven't played any of the major sides apart from Spurs. We haven't. Chelsea's only played the Manchester United. So there's a long way to go. I think a lot of teams are more equal now than they were in the past. But I do think it's going to be very difficult for Liverpool to finish top.
You're listening to Rock and Roll Football on Absolute Radio.
And it's Rock and Roll Football Live, and Arsenal have made a good start at last to a Premier League season. They're still going to be top. They're leading at Crystal Palace by 2-0, and they're down to 10 men. Mikel Arteta sent off early in the second half, but they're going well in Crystal Palace. Their problems are mounting. Well, we've got two of the brightest young coaching prospects in British football patrolling the technical area at Anfield on Rock and Roll Football today. Liverpool manager Brendan Rodgers, who this week has been fielding questions about criticism directed at Steven Gerrard in Sir Alex Ferguson's autobiography. And West Brom boss Steve Clarke has been asked how his baggies managed to bounce back after a winless August.
It's obviously down to the players coming in, because the results since then have improved. But the fact that those players came in, it's not just the players who have come in, it gave a lift to everybody who was here, because we felt in the first three games that maybe we were just lacking in one or two positions, lacking in a little bit of strength and depth, if you like. And when you bring in good players, as we did do, it gives a lift to the players who are already here. So everybody got an extra lift, and I think the performances and the results reflect that.
Gerrard, right-footed efforts! The whole situation changes!
I don't think it was credible, really, in terms of what was said. I only think you need to look at Stephen's career since he's been here, you know, to see that. The accolades he's received all the way through his life, for not managers, but former players and top players. And I seen something the other day that was interesting. I think there was a survey on the PFA Player of the Year, and of all the years that it's been operating, and the player that was voted in that survey who has won that title is the best amongst that was Steven Gerrard, by all accounts, and that was from players and supporters, and may not have won the title, but that's more because of the teams that he's been in rather than him himself, but a world-class player and still operates at a high level.
Liverpool, I think, a different team from what they were last year. They've certainly started the season well. They've started with a good purpose, a good way of playing. Slightly different. They've changed the system. But they've got dangerous players. They've invested a lot of money again in the summer. And it's going to be a difficult game for us. Last season are good memories for us, but that's all they can be. They're no reference to how the game will be this year. It'll be a totally different game.
You know, West Brom have shown already this season that, you know, they've been to Old Trafford and won, so we know they're a dangerous team, and from our experience last year. So, but we know our home games are vital for us, and in the main, apart from one, we've been excellent now for a period of time at home, and we really need to, even though the difficulty of the game is high, we need to ensure that we can get the 3 points of the weekend.
There you are, our two managers this afternoon, Brendan Rodgers and Steve Clarke. It's Liverpool against West Brom here on Rock and Roll Football Live, and in the commentary box with Jim Proudfoot this afternoon. Incidentally, at Crystal Palace 0, Arsenal 2, full-time score. The Gunners still top of the Premier League. Anyway, in the commentary box with Jim, and a welcome back to Craig Levine on Rock and Roll Football. Afternoon, Craig.
Afternoon, Russ.
Steve Clarke of West Brom, a Scotsman like yourself, are we looking at the early career of potential potentially another great Scottish football manager?
Yeah, well, you say early career, and I'm sort of chuckling to myself here. Steve and I are the same age. I feel like I've been doing this.
It wasn't meant that way, Craig, at all, but you know what I mean.
Yeah, well, he's certainly learnt his trade, hasn't he? You know, he's been number two for a long time, and he was in Mourinho's staff for a long time as well. And there's an awful lot of knowledge to have soaked up in the last 10 years or so. And it's great to see him go out on his own. And the things are going reasonably well. You know, they had a good season last season. West Brom have always been known as a kind of, you know, two or three seasons in the Premier League and then drop down and come back up again. But they seem to, you know, they seem to have stabilised things. And, you know, Steve will be really happy, I'm sure, with the way things are going.
Mm. What about Liverpool? Are they title contenders this season, or do you expect them to be in the next couple of years? Is it going the right way for them?
Yeah, I think the Suarez thing settling down is very important for Liverpool, and that partnership with Sturridge that seems to be developing. You know, we always used to talk about in football about striking partnerships, but in recent years, mainly because of the systems that teams have been playing, a lot of teams have played lone strikers, so that sort of partnership hasn't really developed at many clubs. And I see that Brendan is going to a back three, which allows the two strikers and still allows them to flood the midfield. So, yeah, I'm really interested in seeing Liverpool live. I haven't seen them live for a while, and they seem to be heading in the right direction also. And that striking partnership, they're going to be a real handful for any defence.
Yeah, got to keep it together, though, haven't they? I mean, if Luis Suarez did disappear in January or at the end of the season, it's going to be difficult to replace him, Craig. Sir Alex Ferguson, have you read the book, the autobiography? Have you had a little sneaky look at Jim's copy, or have you got your own?
No, I haven't read it.
Well, there was.
I think it will be, you know, a very, very popular book, and you know, Sir Alex has got he's got a sense of humour as well, and I don't think there's ever been any love lost between Liverpool and Manchester United. And it might be just been a little bit mischievous to speak about Steven Gerrard. He's almost thrown a hand grenade in and walked away.
He's got an opinion, and for me that is the main thing. So often in football people don't say what they're really thinking or what they mean, but he's, you know, bitten the bullet, thrown a few hand grenades out there. One of them, which has been kind of overlooked, is he felt that at 39 Brendan Rodgers was too young to become manager of Liverpool.
Yeah, well, I think certainly Brendan's a very ambitious young coach, you know, and I thought it was very significant how he bounced back from his sort of spell at Reading, wasn't it, where things didn't quite go well, and he seems to have sort of taken that in his stride. And he stepped in here at Anfield, which is a very difficult place to stamp your authority as a young coach, and he's managed to do that very well indeed. And his players speak highly of him. He seems to have everybody pulling in the right direction. And this will be a big season for him, though, because, as I say, Liverpool's expectations are always in that sort of top four or five in the league. He has spent some money, and you know, I think the next couple of seasons will be vital for him, because so far things are heading in the right direction.
Yeah.
But, you know, confidence in football teams at times is fragile, and he certainly wouldn't want to lose Suarez if that is the case, or that's the rumours in January.
Very quickly, Craig, another thing in Sir Alex Ferguson's book that raised my eyebrows: he was offered the England job twice. We've had a Swede, we've had an Italian, and let's face it, England as a country has been extremely good to Sir Alex Ferguson. His fame and his wealth and his riches and his lifestyle have come from this country. Why on earth would he say no? Is it because he's a winner?
I think he...
Well, it's a
you
fair
can't
question.
Get me to say that. No, you won't get... I don't think there's an international job in the world that's bigger than Manchester United. And that's the way he felt. I mean, he's the best manager that in my lifetime. I think he's the best manager there's ever been. And, you know, you look at his record there, and he has done, you know, amazing things with Manchester United. And also, international football, you know, probably wouldn't be enough for him. There are long periods in international football where of inactivity, and I think he thrived on being up, you know, 6 o'clock in the morning and being in his work at 7, and been the last to leave the stadium as well. And I think he needed that full on every day. And it's amazing how he's managed to do it for the length of time that he did. But I think international football brings different challenges, and certainly isn't full on, that's for sure. And I think he's done okay in the job that he's done. I don't know what you think. But,
oh, yeah, just a bit. Listen, Arsene, yeah. Very quickly, yes or no, Craig, because we've got to move on. Arsene Wenger said yesterday he wouldn't be at all surprised in 6 months if Sir Alex was back in football.
Well, I would think Arsene Wenger knows him better than me. If he says that, maybe there's some reason to say it. I would have doubted it. I mean, he tried to retire 5 years ago, and how I don't think he'll go back into something that's not as good as what he had. I just don't see that.
No. Craig, great to speak to you. Enjoyed the game this afternoon. Craig Levein in with Jim Proudfoot at Anfield, Liverpool against West Brom. The whole game is coming up. Kick-off less than 15 minutes away.
Rock and roll football with Sky Sports HD.
Your home of football.
This is Absolute Radio.
I'm Lance Corporal Mark Jackson, and I train like this.
Target's front, rapid fire!
No! Well done, guys.
I'm John, a construction manager, and this is how I train.
Target's front, rapid fire!
No! Well done, guys.
John is a Lance Corporal in the Territorial Army. As an Army reservist, he gets paid to train with the regular Army in the UK and places like Kenya and Denmark. His TA training has helped him develop invaluable team-building skills for his civilian career. He's now ready to serve alongside the regular Army whenever he's called upon. The TA are recruiting. Search Join the TA to find out more.
You're in that Vauxhall Masterfit Service Club, aren't you?
Yep.
What's all that about?
Well, it's all about give and take, isn't it?
How do you mean?
Well, Vauxhall give me half-price MOTs, up to 25% off servicing and repairs, and a £25 Masterfit voucher for joining.
Uh-huh. And?
And I take it.
That works.
Doesn't it just?
Join the Vauxhall Masterfit Service Club free today at masterfit.co.uk, where the same experts who built your Vauxhall are the ones who look after it. At participating retailers, terms and conditions apply.
The Hello Weekend break. The boyfriend's romantic last-minute break. The surprise, he's packed for you too break. The does this mean what you think it means break? The romantic dinner break. The Eiffel Tower break. The OMG, he's getting down on one knee break. The, oh, he's just dropped his miniature binoculars break. The Hello Weekend from £119 break. British Airways. To fly, to serve, to Europe.
Book at ba.com/HelloWeekend. Conditions and booking fee may apply. Selected dates and destinations.
The Debenhams Great Gift Card Giveaway. A free £10 gift card when you spend £50 or more. In-store and online. Conditions apply.
Don't get stuck in the cold this winter. For just £20, you'll get ATS Euromaster's full 20-point winter inspection, including fluid top-ups and a litre of Shell oil. You'll even get £10 off your next purchase. Find your nearest centre at atseuromaster.co.uk. ATS, put us to the test. Conditions and exclusions apply.
England have qualified for Brazil 2014. Celebrate by seeing them in action at the home of football, Wembley Stadium, as they take on Chile on Friday the 15th of November. Tickets are on sale now from just £25 at thefa.com/tickets. Bring the family. A family ticket for two adults and two kids is only £60. Get your tickets now at thefa.com/tickets. England versus Chile at Wembley Stadium. Be there. A booking fee of £2.50 per order applies.
This weekend at Homebase, there's 15% off everything, in-store and online. That's 15% on top of our other great offers. Homebase. Love your home this autumn. Exclusions apply.
A short travel update from Absolute Radio and then some more music. That's what you're going to hear next.
Introducing new Shell V-Power Nitro Plus Performance Fuels. Designed to start working the instant they hit your engine. To help remove performance-robbing deposits. New Shell V-Power Nitro Plus Unleaded and Diesel. Performance reinvented. Fill up today. Only at Shell.
Rock and roll football on Absolute Radio.
Live from Anfield.
The defence doesn't look that sure. I don't think the goalkeeper controls the penalty area like he should do, but that may be because he's younger and less experienced than Reina. And I do think we're very vulnerable to set pieces.
And today's game against West Brom, how do you see this one going?
Well, they've beaten us four out of the last five, so I'm not taking it for granted, but I'm hoping that we do get a win.
You're listening to Rock and Roll Football
on Absolute Radio.
Well, another nervous Liverpool fan. It's Liverpool against West Brom from the Barclays Premier League here on Rock and Roll Football on Absolute Radio this afternoon. Don't forget, if you can't stay with us, you can take us with you wherever you go. Our live scores app is available for your Android or your iPhone device and also your tablet, and you can get it from iTunes or from absoluteradio.co.uk. So if you've been grabbed by the ear and said, we'll go and do some early Christmas shopping, darling, download the app and take us with you. And Righty will be here at 5 o'clock. Ricky Hatton and Joe Montana, an NFL legend, amongst his guests. Right, let's get the team news. A little reminder at Anfield. Here's Jim.
Well, there have been a little bit of conjecture about who was going to play at left back for Liverpool today, because when the official team sheet came out, we were told it was Ali Sissoko. Then a published one circulates around the press box which says it's Jose Enrique. Having said that, I can confirm it will be Sissoko who plays at left back. So it's just the one change as far as Liverpool are concerned from the side that drew at Newcastle, and that's the return of Lucas into the midfield with Victor Moses, the player that drops down to the bench. As far as West Brom are concerned, one change for them as well from the side that drew at Stoke. Berahino's the player that misses out. Anelka comes in. And the sages from the Black Country tell me they think that Anelka will play in behind Anichebe and Sessegnon will move out to the left-hand side. It is the first time that Anelka and Anichebe have both started a game together for West Bromwich Albion. Kick-off here at a noisy Anfield about 9 minutes away, Russ.
OK, thank you, Jim. Tony DiRigo in the studio with me. 3 3 o'clock kick-offs in the Barclays Premier League apart from our game. And here's Tony with team news.
Yes, Manchester United Stoke. Robin van Persie returns to the starting lineup after missing out on the Champions League action in midweek. It also starts for Shinji Kagawa and Tom Cleverley. And for Stoke, Stoke defenders Ryan Shawcross and Jeff Cameron both in the starting lineup after being doubtful through illness and injury respectively. Now, Aston Villa, two changes against Everton. It's Christian Benteke returns from hip injury to start and Kozak drops to the bench. Stephen Pienaar starts for Everton after making a scoring return from injury against Hull City last weekend. Lukaku continues up front. That's important.
You know what this game is?
What?
The battle of the big Belgians.
Big, strong Belgians. And well, I tell you what, looking forward to the World Cup. If those two are firing, watch out for them. Norwich versus Cardiff. Norwich City forwards Ricky van Wolfswinkel and Joanne Elmander are only fit enough for the bench as Gary Hooper starts up front. And for Cardiff, Cardiff City are without winger Craig Noon due to injuries suffered in midweek. Odin Wingie, Jordan Mutch and Fraser Campbell all start for the Bluebirds.
OK, you're watching Manchester United against Stoke City. Tony, I'm going to be keeping an eye on Aston Villa against Everton, the battle of the big Belgians. But we're at Liverpool this afternoon. Liverpool against West Brom, and life at Liverpool seems a lot rosier these days. They've only dropped 7 points this season and they're currently right in the mix at the top of the table. They have the SAS, the best strike partnership in the Premier League. Are we witnessing the start of another red revolution on Rock and Roll Football?
It's about a group of people. When you come to a big club or any club, you can't do it on your own.
Brendan Rodgers, young manager, he's got new ideas.
Play four for Sturridge, whose goal side, a brilliant instinctive flick into the net. Suarez! Header hits the bar and he's put in by Suarez! Decent ball in, Suarez!
What's the future for Liverpool?
Liverpool fans believe in the long-term vision.
We talked about the potential that we have in the players still to grow.
You want to see Liverpool back right amongst it.
The players have been clinical in games. Their appetite for the game is very good.
Gerrard, right-footed efforts! The whole situation changes!
Liverpool is an iconic club worldwide.
There is no other than Liverpool.
There you go, Liverpool Football Club in action against West Brom this afternoon. Don't forget, we've got Ian Wright joined by Ian Stone from 5 o'clock. And Wrighty's had a busy week. He was watching Arsenal lose in the Champions League. He also, on Monday night, Wright and Bright opened their very own lounge at Selhurst Park. But Arsenal have done the business there in the top of the Premier League. Palace 0, Arsenal 2, and he's here, Wrighty, 5 o'clock tonight. No Brighty this week, just Wrighty. Joe Montana and Ricky Hatton amongst his guests, including you, of course, if you want to give him a ring a little bit later on in the show. Right then, the main event is on the way. In the next few weeks, you know, we're going to show us, I think, whether Liverpool are back as title contenders. Brendan Rodgers insists that the top four perhaps is the height of their ambitions this season. But is he telling the truth? The Barclays Premier League is for sure wide open this season. All sorts of crazy results. West Brom are proof of that. They ran rings around Manchester United at Old Trafford on their own patch. And we're live from Anfield on Absolute Radio for you today. And in the commentary box, bringing you every kick, the former Scotland manager, Craig Levein, and our very own Jim Proudfoot.
Well, it wouldn't quite be a unique occurrence, but a little bit of history nevertheless. A West Brom win today will make them the first side to win three in a row at Anfield since Chelsea in the middle of the last decade, when the Blues' first team coach was Steve Clarke. Clark's already masterminded a win at Old Trafford this season. Can they replicate that success with another attacking performance and blunt Liverpool's prolific SAS? Who dares wins? Liverpool West Brom, live on Absolute Radio. Kickoff is moments away.
Rock and roll football with Sky Sports HD.
Watch Sunderland entertain Newcastle, followed by title challengers Chelsea versus Manchester City this Super Sunday, live only on Sky Sports.